Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Gboko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
We are going ahead to look at the ministry of the cross. One thing we said yesterday is that when Jesus agreed to go to the cross, He did so in order to bring many sons out of bondage unto glory. We said the cross was the mystery that if the devil had known, he will never have crucified the Lord of glory. If the devil had known what God was planning with the cross, he will never have attempted it. And I say to you that the cross has happened. Satan cannot undo it. He has lost a battle. And that's why a judgment had been written against him. And that judgment said, now shall the prince of this world be cast out. And if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men. I want you to know that the cross is the basis for us to draw men unto God. It is because the cross has happened, that's why we have the authority and the audacity to call men, to draw them to Jesus. When you begin to go out and speak to men, I want you to know that the ministry of the cross is what actually makes it possible for men to be liberated from the power of darkness. The cross is the instrument that terminates our old life for the exchange of another life, even the life of Christ. In Romans 12, we noted that what made death and darkness to reign is because the life we have inherited from Adam is a life of disobedience. And the Bible says, by the disobedience of one man, many were made sinners, and death reigned, and the devils took over because of the disobedience of one man. But then the Bible says, but by the obedience of another, even Jesus Christ, we shall reign in life. So we want to look at the exchange, the termination of the old life in order for the new to come forth. And the passages that we are going to read, Romans chapter 6, we are going to read verse 6 and 7. We are going to read Romans chapter 7, verse 1 to 6. Galatians 5, verse 17 to 25. Galatians 2, verse 20. This that we are going to be studying is very major. It's a very major focus and mystery of the cross in setting men free from the tyranny of sin and self. Shall we turn our Bibles, all of you, to Romans chapter 6. Yes, sir.
Romans 6, verse 6.
Yes, sir.
Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin.
Praise the Lord. Can we try that from NIV?
For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Because anyone who has died has been freed from sin.
From sin. Can we get that from contemporary English version? CEV.
We know that the persons we used to be.
We know that the persons we used to be.
We are nailed to the cross with Jesus.
Was nailed to the cross with Jesus.
This was done so that our sinful bodies will no longer be the slaves of sin.
Yes, sir.
We know that sin doesn't have power over dead people.
All right. Now, that's the first matter I want to please spend time to think through before we go ahead. When Jesus Christ accepted to go to the cross, he was doing so for something to happen. He was going to the cross in order to carry the life, the man that we used to be. The life that used to be subject to sin and to Satan and to darkness, to terminate it. But we will not be able to spend time to deal with that immediately until we will go to chapter 7. Romans chapter 7 will give us the rationale to Romans chapter 6. If you are reading your Bible and you get to Romans chapter 7, he began with an analogy in order to give us an understanding of what God did as discussed in Romans chapter 6. And can we quickly understand that analogy? Know ye not, brethren, for I speak to them that know the law, how that the law has dominion over a man as long as he lives. For the woman which has an husband is bound by the law to her husband so long as what? As he lives. But if the husband be dead, she is loosed from the law of her husband. So then, if while her husband lives, she be married to another man, she shall be called what? An adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that law, so that she is no adulteress, even though she be married to another man. Can we quickly understand that discussion before we go ahead? The law has dominion over a man as long as he lives. Does that make sense? If a man is alive, that's when the law has power, dominion over him. When a man is dead, what has happened to the law over him? The law is dead. A man is under the law only as long as he lives. Sometimes, if a criminal has committed an offense that is very, very grave. And judgment was to be cast upon him according to the law. And just before they will invoke the judgment on him, he dies. What happened to the case? The case is finished. You cannot bring the dead corpse to the court and be asking him to explain why he disobeyed. And even if you decide to sentence him to prison and said according to the law because of what he has done, we sentence him to 15-year imprisonment with hard labor. What is the High Court judge doing? What is he doing? He was joking. It's a useless judgment. Why? The man is dead. Did you understand that first allegory? Eh? Now, what is the second issue that the word of God was written again? He said, the woman which has an husband is bound by the law to her husband. When? So long as he lives. Which means, a woman that is married to her husband remains under the law of her husband as long as either she is alive or the husband is alive. Are we together now? Okay. So which means there are two cases in which a woman that is married to an husband can be free from the law to her husband. What is the first case? If the woman herself does what? Dies. What happened to the law of her husband over her? Eh? It's finished. Even if the husband is so annoyed with her that he had planned to punish her and then he just woke up and discovered that the woman died. What happened to his annoyance? And even if he's annoyed to the point that he decided to kick the dead corpse, who will be pained? Eh? And if you see him beating the dead corpse, where will you take that man immediately? Psychiatry. The reason is because when a woman is dead, is free from the law of her husband. That is one case, Abi. What is the second case in which a woman can be free from the law of her husband? If the husband dies. Are we together? Now, please, in a short while, I'm praying that God will give you an understanding to the passage. Because it's so crucial that you have to understand it in order for you to understand this first major mystery of the cross for our deliverance. Now, the two scenarios that we are painting, if we choose the first, where the woman dies, a woman that is dead, number one, she's free from the husband. No matter how the husband was, she's free. But what is the disadvantage? Can that woman have opportunity of marrying another man? Why not? She's dead. She's free from the problem of her husband, but she has no opportunity to experience another kind of life. It means she would die. Number one, whatever the husband used to do to her, she's no more under that bondage. But then she has no second opportunity of living or getting married to another one. But if the husband dies, she's free not only from the law of her husband, she's also free for something else, isn't it? What is she free again for? She's free to marry another man. Are we together now? All right. And I want you to please follow. Even though the matter looks like as if we want to talk about marriage, but this particular passage itself is not a passage about marriage. It's not a passage about human marriage. It's a passage that is giving an analogy for an understanding of what God has decided to do to set me and you free from the power of sin and of the flesh. How did we know that? You will see the connection. In verse 3 it says, so then, if while our husband lives, she be married to another man, what shall we call her? She shall be called an adulteress. Why are we calling her an adulteress? Because her husband is still alive and she is trying to be married to another man. She's an adulteress. But if her husband be dead, she is free from that law. Which law? The law of her husband. The law that binds her to her husband. She is free from that law. Now I want you to understand. I'm reading King James. You will notice that he did not say she's free from the law. We are not talking of the general law. We are talking about from which law? That law. The law that binds her to her husband. Hallelujah. Oh my God. Are we together? Now, if her husband be dead, she is free from that law, so that she is no adulteress, though she be married to another man. Are we on the same page to that point? All right. Now, what was our concern about this passage? Go to verse 4. He said, wherefore, did you see? Is there a wherefore in your Bible? Or a therefore, if you are reading a modern translation? Or you will see another word, if they did not say therefore, they may say, so then. So then. But now I want you to see now. Wherefore, my brethren, you also have become dead to the law. Let's wait. Who is carrying New King James? What did New King James say, please? Therefore, yes.
Therefore, my brethren,
yes,
you also have become dead to the law through the body of Christ.
Yes.
That you may be married to another.
Now, wait. Does it mean that the matter between us and the flesh that has made us not to be able to stand for God because of sin, rising and falling, does it mean that the matter between us and the flesh is marriage. Eh? Oh my God. Eh?
Yes.
It's like we were married.
Yes, sir.
All of you, please listen. The matter between us and the natural man, Mr. Flesh, that has not allowed us to do anything for God properly, is marriage. If you read verse 5, it says, when we were in the flesh, the motions of sins, we are going to talk about that later on, which were by the law, as if when we were married to the flesh, are you hearing me? Every desire, every motion of sin, every demand for you to commit sin, oh, are you listening to me? Is by law. Any human being that is born of the flesh is married to the flesh. And as long as our husband, Mr. Flesh, is alive, are you hearing me? It is by law that we must produce sin. It is not by choice. It is by what? It's by law. It is by law that you must get angry when your husband, Mr. Flesh, is alive. Even when you say, I don't want to be angry, I don't want to be angry, you are joking. When your husband said, I am motioning for anger now, did you have alternative? Eh? What did you notice? You find yourself, you did it. You don't want to do it, but the law demands that it must be done. It's by law. It's not by choice. If it is by choice, I know so many people, they don't want to be living the way they are living. I know how many times somebody is going. You already know that this relationship is not correct. You know it. But when the motion of sin say, go and meet that girl, you know that it is not correct. Oh, you say, Kai, but why am I going there now? Ah. And I say, I will not go again. But where are you going? What is making you to go there? Somebody inside of you is by law. In fact, when you get there, I will hear you say, I know I should not be doing this thing. But I can't stop doing it. How many of you have got such experience before? Yes, it is by law. It's not by choice. Any man that is born of the flesh is married to the flesh and married to serve the flesh and married to produce for the flesh. Even when we say, go and shine the light, you can't shine the light when the man that you are married to is saying, no, don't put yourself in danger. You just find that something inside of you say, you better cool down. It is by law. The motions of sin is by what? Is by law. When we say the motions of sin, that is me, a motivation to do things that whether you like it or not, are you understanding? There is already a motion. If it was by choice, you might say, I do not second that motion. But because it is a law, what must you do? What must you do? You just have to respond to the motion. The Bible said the motions of sin. What sin, Mr. Flesh, your husband, is demanding that you should produce for him is by law. And I want to tell you, when you are married to Mr. Flesh, Mr. Flesh does not beg for your support. What does he do? He dictates. He demands. He compels. And until you did it, you had no peace. Until you succumb, you cannot be at rest because it is by law. Hallelujah. Do you understand that now? Secondly, let me now get you to understand another thing. Because if you don't understand this, you might not know the gravity of it. It says, as long as the husband is alive, if the woman attempts to marry another one, what shall we be called? An adulteress. What does that also mean? That if Mr. Flesh, our legal husband, is still alive, every attempt you make to be married to another person, even if that person is Jesus Christ, what shall you be called? This is not easy for you to understand, Abi. How can they say, I am committing adultery by trying to be married to Jesus because Mr. Flesh is not dead? That is the truth. That's why when you are reading the Bible keeps saying, even the prayer of a man that is still under the power of the flesh is an abomination to God. Jesus does not need it. I don't know whether you are getting me. That even though you have a beautiful voice and you would like to sing for Jesus, but your husband, Mr. Flesh, has not died, trying to sing for Jesus when Mr. Flesh has not died, what are you doing? What are you doing? You are committing adultery. And I tell you, Mr. Flesh does not even agree. As you are singing, Mr. Flesh will come and say, for whom are you singing? Before you know it, he will collect it. Even when you start that you are singing for Jesus, he will come and collect it. That's why, as long as Mr. Flesh has not died, any ministry you are trying to do for Jesus is bastardized. The reason why the church has not really made serious impact is because Mr. Flesh continuously collected whatever people were doing. Why would two brothers who are in the ministry be fighting themselves? Who is the root of fighting? It's the flesh. Can you imagine that? I have seen people, we go for meetings and we are preaching, and maybe a brother was asked to bring a morning devotion. Are you understanding? And as he was preaching the morning devotion, he mistakenly quoted what the man of God, the major man of God, wanted to preach. You are not hearing me at all. All the verses that the major man of God wanted to quote, he has quoted them. Then you hear the major man of God say, he has stolen my message. When we tell you to go and give up the money devotion, you should know, you should have limited yourself. Why did you dabble into the main theme of the message? What do you want me to preach again? Now, excuse me, what is causing that kind of problem? Talk to me. It's Mr. Flesh that has not died. Mr. Flesh, when it has not died, even on the pulpit, he is busy collecting the results because you belong to him. So the Bible said, wherefore, my brethren, you also, you have become dead to that law, to the law of Mr. Flesh, by the body of Christ, so that you might be married. Did you understand the word there? Can you check that verse 4? Did you see that in your own verse 4? Can you check? I want you all to check. Romans chapter 7 verse 4. Did you see it? Wherefore, my brethren, you also, you have become dead to the law by the body of Christ, that you should be married to another. And he wanted to note, to whom are we to be married? To whom are we to be married in that verse 4? Even to him who is raised from the dead. Who is that? Hallelujah. So which means, before you can be married to Jesus to produce fruit unto God, for you to carry a life that will be fruitful for God, what must have happened, sir? Death. Death of what? Of your flesh. I want you to have an understanding that any man who has not experienced the death of Mr. Flesh in a definite manner has nothing to contribute to God's work except contamination. It is so fearful to me that as I read on and on in the Word of God, I find that God himself does not want any flesh to glory in his sight. When Jude was writing toward the end of his life, he said, you must hate the garment that is what? Spotted. By who? By the flesh. When the Holy Spirit was speaking about the anointing, even in the book of Exodus, he said, upon man's flesh, the anointing oil must not be poured. And I said, how can you pour anointing on a man's head and it do not touch his body? It became clear to me that God was not talking about the body. What was he talking about? He was talking about that man, Mr. Flesh. Mr. Flesh is the major obstacle to doing anything for God. When you talk of the love of money, it is Mr. Flesh. When you talk about arrogance and pride, it is the manifestation of that man. And unless your marriage with him is terminated, are we together? You are not free to be married to another man, even Jesus. And without wanting to overemphasize that, until your relationship with Mr. Flesh is terminated by death, you are not in position to be commissioned, to be sent forth, and say, go and shine the light. There's no light, you will shine. Let's not deceive ourselves. Let me not deceive you. You have no light to shine. Mr. Flesh, hey. Can you imagine that you're a teacher in a secondary school? Are you hearing me? Eh? And you are trying to help the children. And there was this young girl that you are trying to show her the love of God. And you are trying to help her. And you are explaining things to her. And the girl, in her own arrogance, are you hearing me? She said, Mrs. Asikaru is begging me because she's afraid that I will report her. Are you hearing that? Eh? Then somebody said, did you see what that girl, Enne, was saying? That is because you are afraid. That's why you are calling her and begging her. What will happen to Mrs. Asikaru? Eh? Something in her. We do what? We rise and say, what? Me begging you to help with your head? Who are you? Who is your mother? Who born you? I have been teaching before your mother went to school. I was just trying to preach to you so that you can be saved. If you don't want to be saved, go to hell. Let me ask you, who has taken over? Is Mr. Flesh can even allow you to do something for 2 years. The day he stands up like this, one decision you will take, what will he do to it? Scatter. If you are not delivered from that marriage, whatever you produce, he will collect it. In Thief land and in Igbo land, when you are married, are you hearing me? Even if you are quarreling your husband and you went somewhere and you started delivering children for someone else, are you hearing me? As long as you have not returned what? The dowry. All the children you are delivering in that place, to whom does he belong? You are joking. As long as Mr. Flesh has not ended in your life, and the only thing that do us part is death. If it has not happened, whatever you are doing, no matter the ministry, your husband will come one of these days. To do what? To collect it. How many work of God that we thought it was the work of God has been collected by Mr. Flesh? It's because Mr. Flesh said, well, me, I have not divorced her. And there is not even a divorce. Only death can do me and her part. And since death has not occurred, that I know, I'm going to collect everything. How many great work that we thought it was the work for God has been taken over by Mr. Flesh. Mr. Flesh. Mr. Flesh. Mr. Flesh. If the flesh has not died, sir, a great work, he will come and collect it. Suddenly you will hear that this one has decided, has done like this, this one, he has divided like this, this one has done like this. What is the meaning of that? It is that the man that we thought died, didn't die. He has come to collect all that we thought you were doing for Jesus Christ. So, but where is the key in that passage that is leading us to deal with this as the first critical instrument? Where is the key? All of you, go back now to that Romans chapter 7. We're reading verse 4, and we're reading verse 5, and we're reading verse 6. Let me read from King James. Wherefore, my brethren, you also, you have become dead to the law. How? Can you see in your Bible? How? By yourself? Eh? By fighting? By struggling? How? By the body of Christ. I want all of you to note that. We can only become dead to that law of our marriage to Mr. Flesh, not by ourselves. Because if we are going to be dead to that law by ourselves, it means we must wait. Until when? Until when? Until you die. But why couldn't wait until we die? It's because it is given unto man to die once. And after that, what? You can become free from anger if you fall down dead here. You can be free from loss of money. Once you die now, even if they bring dollar and they are putting it in your nose, you're already free. But when you die like that, you have no second opportunity to do what? To be married to another. And then you can only be waiting to give account of all you did while you were in this body. Which means you are only going to face judgment of all the work you produce for Mr. Flesh. That is why we cannot say until we die. When I hear some preachers saying, well, nobody can be free from sin until you die. It means that if you wait till you die before you get married to another, you have already finished your destiny. It means the only work that will be standing against your name is the works you did for the flesh. And that is very terrible. So, did you see he said, by the body of Christ? I'm sure that we are going to get some versions that will use the word through. Right, read. What do you have, sir?
So, my brothers, you also died.
You also died
to the Lord through the body of Christ.
Hallelujah! How is that death going to occur? Through the body of Christ. This is where the cross is coming seriously in. If to say I will be free from that law by myself while I'm still alive, then we will not need the cross. But because you cannot be alive and be free from the flesh by yourself, if you have to be dead, then you have no opportunity to be useful to God in any way. That is why the mystery of how can God terminate what is a marital commitment between us and the natural man, and we are still available in our lifetime to produce fruit unto God by Jesus Christ. How will God do that? Yes, sir. Through the body, of Christ. Yes.
That you might belong to another.
That you may belong to another.
To him who was raised from the dead.
Yes.
In order that we might bear fruit to God.
Unto God. Who is to him that we should now be married? Jesus Christ, who was raised from the dead. Contemporary English version, CEV. Yes.
That is how it is with you, my friends.
That is how. Thank God for the Bible. That is how. How is it with you, my friends? How is it with you? Just like that. It is marriage. It is a marriage. The issue of why you are always falling into sin is a marriage. The reason why the motions of sin are always working in your life by law is a marriage. And until that marriage is dissolved, and it cannot be dissolved in the court of law, the only thing that dissolves it is what? Death. Either your death or his death. How will God arrange his death so that I can be left alone to serve God? Yes, Sister Dingwe.
You are now part of the body of Christ.
Uh-huh.
And are dead to the power of the law.
And you are dead to the power of the law.
You are free to belong to Christ.
You are free to now be married, to belong to Jesus. Hallelujah! Now, if I decide now to live for Jesus Christ, I am free. I am free now to serve God. And it's a joy to be free to live in holiness. It's a joy to be free never to serve anger. You may not know. Only those of you that have been a victim of anger, you will know when you are free. When people do something that normally make your stomach to turn, now instead of that, you just see yourself smiling and say, thank you, Jesus. Your hypertensive drug, you have dropped it because now you are free to live. You are free to walk with God. You are free to be married to another man. You are free. Are you free? Are you free? Eh? Bimpe, are you free? Free? So that if you produce something for God, we are not expecting the former husband to come and collect it. You are free. Hallelujah. Who is free here? Aha. You see, when a man has not experienced the cross, so now, so that I can draw that to a conclusion, you will now return. And I want you to return because I want you to catch something, after which every passage I'll be reading will be easy for me to go from there. Praise the Lord. This is a very fundamental issue. Fundamental. A man that is not yet dead to Mr. Flesh is not free for God. My brother, and I will tell you how to ensure that there is no reconnection. I'll need to deal with that. But unless you are free from Mr. Flesh, you are not free for God. You are not free for Christ. In fact, if Christ even showed interest in marrying you, are you hearing me? The man inside say, "What do you look for here? I am still here, and you
you are the one that said
nobody should commit adultery.
I wonder what you want to do with him and with her.
Mind your business. I'm still here.
I didn't know this when I used to start preaching.
You know, there are some messages that you preach that does not make sense. What is the message? When you see a sinner, and you are telling him not to sin. Is that a correct message? You see fish, and you tell fish, never you swim again. What are you doing? You are just talking useless. Fish will say, do you not know I'm fish? What else should a fish do than to do what? Than to swim. So you know, when I see any man who is born of the flesh, my message to him is never try to be gentle. And don't get annoyed with your wife. Even if your wife annoys you, just tell her, I love you. Synagogue sermon. Can it be done? Eh? Why you are talking like that? You will see something, you say, excuse me, is it me only you should talk to? Talk to my wife also, that she should behave herself. Yes? Somebody should know I am in charge in this house. Pastor, tell her to behave herself. I can't love somebody who does not respect somebody. Who is that somebody? He's inside. Sometimes we will be in the church council meeting, and people are making contribution. And because this young man that spoke, as he stood up, Mr. Flesh inside of you already sized him. He said, this man, give and take, he must not be less than 15 years younger than me. Our last born seniors him. Is it because I'm a pastor here that he now has audacity to be querying and asking me questions? We're in the church meeting, you know, we have prayed. Holy Ghost, come and take control. We are here again. That's how we started the meeting. Are you understanding? Mr. Flesh even sang that song. But when this young man stood up and made a point and said, I would like this council to please ask the pastor to explain to us what actually happened between our last meeting in February and this meeting we are doing in April, because I remember we decided that pastor should do this according to the minute. Can you please allow pastor to explain to us why those things were not done? Something is boiling. He has not yet finished. Sit down. The Bible says, obey your leaders. Excuse me, when were you born? when did you join this church? Who gave you the right to be querying the man of God? Sit down before I call fire on your head. Then everybody said, Pastor, please now, please. They say no. What is not good is not good. That we are here in church does not mean somebody should forget decorum. In my village, boys don't talk when elders are speaking. Before this meeting can continue, let Brother Charles, or what do you call his name, let him excuse us from this meeting. Yes. And I'm not going to talk until he moves. You see? Who has taken over now? That man. When you have time, read Galatians 5 and you will see the catalog of what Mr. Flesh does. I wish you read it. And he's always struggling with the Spirit. He doesn't agree with the Holy Ghost. So as long as he is here, you cannot do what you want to do. You may have good wish. I will serve God. I will serve God. Mr. Flair said, for what? Have you settled my case first? So until a man is freed, because it's by marriage. You were married to the flesh. And for you to be free to serve God, that flesh must be crucified. And so when the Bible said, through the body of Christ, I saw that Jesus, who knew no sin, who had walked here, when it was time for him to have been glorified, he said, yes, the hour has come that I should be glorified, but unless the corn of wheat falls to the ground and dies, the people were even asking, how will you say the Son of Man, which is Christ, will die? The Bible said that the Son of Man, which is Christ, will never die. He will live forever. How are you saying you are going to die? Who is this Son of Man? They can't understand that. Why should he go and die? They did not know that what God decided to do is that God took the sinless Christ and decided to pour into him my own husband. Hallelujah. Your own husband, Mr. Flesh. And the Bible said, he who knew no sin was made, what? Sin. Was made the embodiment of sin. And what did he do? He went to the cross. And did what? And laid him there. So, did you understand where we have reached? Can I now go back to Romans chapter 6? Can we now go to Romans 6? Now, go back to Romans 6 now. Romans 6, that verse 6 we read. I was wishing all the time was available, but that's the point. We're stopping on that. Now, Vimpe, can you read your CEV at this time? Just
we
read.
We know that the persons we used to be.
Wait. All of you, look at the Bible now. I know the King James said, knowing this, that our old man. I know that NIV said, we know that our old self. Abi? Eh? And I know that good news. Does anybody have good news there? What did he say in good news? Yes?
Our old beings have been put to death.
We know that our old being. But you see, me, two of those versions are exciting to me. My old man. I wish I would have put it in my language. You know, when you are greeting women, and when women are talking among themselves, sometimes, instead of saying my husband, what do you normally say when you are chatting with someone else? Talk to me. What do you say? My man. My man. Abi? And my man. My man doesn't like that too. My old man doesn't like that. And sometimes when they want to greet themselves, they say, how is your man? You are not hearing at all.
Yes, sir.
I thought it's a slang that you normally speak. How is your man? My own man. My man. Now, so when the Bible said, knowing this, that our old man, the person that we used to be, our old being. So let's note that. Now, see Evie.
We know that the persons we used to be were
Honestly speaking, I want you to note that because it's important. What was crucified with Jesus Christ is not your anger. It's not just your fornication. If that is it, the man that produced those things will produce again. What God did for us on the cross was not a cutting of trees, of leaves, and removing fruits and cutting branches. What did he decide to do for us? The person we used to be. The producer of all our mistakes. The one that never allows us to serve God uninterruptedly. The one that interrupts the purpose of God in our lives. What did God do? It was nailed to the cross.
With Jesus.
With Jesus. Please start again.
We know that the persons we used to be.
We know that the persons we used to be.
Were nailed to the cross with Jesus.
Were nailed to the cross with Jesus Christ.
This was done so that our sinful bodies would no longer be the slaves of sin.
Yes. Verse 7.
We know that sin doesn't have power over dead people.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, can I ask you to note that the cross was God's method and instrument to take away our former husband and to get him to the cross where he was nailed to the cross, leaving us alone to get married even to Jesus who raised again for us. Am I communicating? Did you understand? So when the Bible said we know the person that we used to be has been nailed to the cross with Jesus Christ so that our sinful bodies, our body that Mr. Flesh had used and misused, may be free, may no longer be slave to sin, because we now know that sin has no power over dead people. Do you understand to that point? Praise the Lord. So can I now ask you, since I said Galatians 5, I've given you an assignment to read from that verse 17. And I want you to read only verse 24 in order to move forward. Can we read verse 24? Galatians 5, 24. Yes.
And they that are Christ's,
they that are Christ's,
have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts.
Hallelujah. How did King James put it? New King James. And those who are Christ, they have crucified the flesh with his passions and desires. We know those who belong to Christ. Now, how did good news put verse 24?
And those who belong to Jesus,
those who belong to Christ Jesus,
have put to their human nature.
They have put to death their human nature
with all his passions.
With all his what? With all his passions and desires. I want all of you to please note that verse 24. And those who belong to Christ, they have crucified. Let's note that. You cannot go and shine light if Mr. Flesh has not been crucified. And honestly speaking, you do not belong to Christ yet if the flesh has not been crucified. If the flesh has not been crucified, brother, you are none of his. You know, when Jesus Christ met people and said, whosoever he be of you that does not deny himself and take up his cross, he cannot be my disciple. I don't know how we preach the gospel to many people, and Mr. Flesh is intact, and we have said that they are going to heaven. It is this kind of muddled up messages that has brought weakness to the body of Christ. How can people that are dead to the flesh be fighting over the pulpit? Are you hearing me? This problem of denominationalism, that preachers are fighting against preachers, this one is speaking against that one is not agreeing with this one is standing here. Who is there at work? Talk to me. The flesh. How did we in the first place claim that those ones actually belong to Christ? If we are going to expect a revival, we must confront the flesh with the cross. If you are going to be part of what God wants to do in the coming days, we cannot spare your flesh. Everything that comes from the flesh is contrary to the spirit, and it is contamination to the spirit, and it is a threat to the purpose of God. The flesh is the enemy. And some of you are saying, what, why is he talking like that? It's because nothing has started between you and Jesus Christ until Mr. Flesh is dead. Don't even let anybody say you are a Christian when you are still married to Mr. Flesh. Praise the Lord. So, the cross was what God devised to end our relationship with Mr. Flesh. And Jesus had to go to the cross bearing our old nature to crucify him there. So please read again for me that verse 24.
And they that are Christ,
they that are Christ,
have crucified
the Lord. Have. Did they say they will? Did they say they are trying to? Eh? What did he say? If it has not happened, you are not of Christ. It is something that God must put in your life as a past tense. They that belong to Christ have. Because that is the beginning of any connection with Christ's life. What has become so overwhelming to me is to wake up and discover that 1,000 work a man has done, when they are testing it and they are testing it with fire, and they discover that they are all contaminated by the flesh, and flesh cannot please God. And they say, put him aside. He preached quite all right, but the motive is Mr. Flesh. He gave a special number, quite all right, but he did that to counteract another brother with whom he is competing. And you may not understand that Mr. Flesh can be a powerful preacher. Can I tell you so? Mr. Flesh, what did I say? He can be a powerful preacher. And I know what it means. You know, sometimes you come to the pulpit and you saw a brother who you have been wanting to score a point with. Are you understanding? He has done something and you have not had opportunity to do what? To deal with him. Now, with microphone, with pulpit, where nobody can query you. Yeah. Let us pray. Let us pray. Close your eyes. Stop looking around. Obey your God. In the name of Jesus. Let the fire come down. Let all the arrogant people in this church, let them know that you have sent me. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Then you carry your dagger. One corner of your eye is somewhere. And there's always a Bible verse in the hand of the flesh to do anything he wanted to do. When you finish that message, even you yourself, you know, when you get down, you say, I gave it to him. Gave it to him. Moses, come. Moses, yeah. I dealt with it. Did you notice that? I dealt with it. Yes. I thank God for the opportunity. If he likes, let him attack me again. The microphone is in my hand. The pulpit is in my hand. Someone will have to live somewhere for somebody. Praise God. Mr. Flesh. And because the man himself knows that this particular utterance is not from God, it's from you, for him, he himself. Say, if he does not know what to say, let him keep quiet. What is he talking about? So once the church finishes, you see and say, yes, you can preach against me, man of God. I heard you, but we will meet. Does that happen not in the church? Mr. Flesh is an offense to the work of God. And unless your own have been crucified, you have no business claiming to be married to Jesus. Jesus won't marry you. He will not put his own seed where Mr. Flesh will collect it. I will be asking you when it is time to pray. This is crucial. He will say, yes, you are the light unto the nation, not you, whose flesh have not been crucified. Not you, who is still a servant of the flesh. Not you, who is still married, and your marriage to the flesh is as intact, even though you have learned some religious language. Even though you have known how to sing Christian songs. Even though you know how to pretend. Oh my God. No, it's all right. It's all right. It's all right. Let me go away. But Mr. Flesh, he can be gentle until you give him the sword. And there are some of you who are junior pastors. It appears as if you are submissive. It was a plan. Mr. Flesh says, be gentle until you take over. When you take over, you know what to do. The one time that your senior pastor allowed you to preach when he traveled. Say, so I thank God my day has come. What did I say? My day has come. This is the day the Lord has made for me. It looks like the Bible. Abi? But somebody say, for me. So before you know it, he has said something just to daze the people, just to turn their hearts. I hope you remember Absalom. Did you remember Absalom? Oh my God, you didn't remember Absalom. How did he begin? Come here. Four of you, come. Meg, follow them. You see, just come. The brother that carries my, please come. And these are people that are coming for fellowship. They want to go and see the senior man of God there. And Brother Absalom said, oh, my brother, how are you?
Fine, sir.
Oh, God. Your face is shining. I've not seen you for a long time. I see you going to senior pastor, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
What's the problem? Has he had time for you?
Not really.
You know, in recent time, he has become too busy. He's very busy nowadays. He doesn't have time to look at people. What concerns him now, he looks at fights, he looks at offering. That's why some of us are there. To stand with you. Yes, to stand with you. And I want you to know, you are in my heart. 2 days ago, as I was praying, the Lord told me, He said, do you notice Yinka Adeboye? The eyes of the Lord is upon him. Even though people don't recognize that some of us also have an anointing. They think it's the anointing of the big man of God, but these are old anointing. You need new and fresh anointing. Kneel down. Let me just pray for you. Mashanda Yabakun. Nekera Baba. Nosoto Yoruba. Promote him. In the name of Jesus. And as I started praying for him, Spirit of God, show him how much I love him. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. Brother. Now, and there's a prayer meeting in my house. Meant for champions. For which people? Champions. And as you are coming in, the Lord said, it's one of them. It's one of them. But you can still go and see the man of God if you want.
No need.
Ah, Brauche. Praise the Lord. How are you? How's your wife?
She's fine.
What about that pregnancy?
God helped us.
God helped. I was praying.
Thank you, sir.
I was praying.
Thank you, sir.
I remember one night, the Lord will not let me sleep. Said, pray for Uche and his wife. That the baby that is lying diagonal.
God answered your prayer, sir.
God answered the prayer.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for my brother Uche. Thank you. I just bless you. These are people that need pastoral care. These are sheep that have been looking for shepherding. But Lord, you know how to raise shepherd for your people. I thank you. Please bless him. And concerning this new anointing, locate him in it.
Amen.
Together
Amen.
With his wife.
Amen.
Locate him in the anointing. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Rauchi, Tuesday is the prayer for the champions. You hear? I'll see you.
Thank you, sir.
Don't let anybody confuse you. Don't die with the old. You hear? Eh? Some people are on their way out. You are too young to go down with the old. But the ball is your court. Margaret. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, my God. When I just see you, I see the glory of God on your face. Where have you been? You mean you have been around, lost in the crowd? A person like you shouldn't be lost in the crowd. God is going to bring you out. And he's going to lift you up. Your time has come. You are going to shine. You're going to shine. You see, you know, God wants you to shine. People have been putting you under the bushes. You have a good voice, but because you are not in the good book of some people, they have kept your voice under the bushel. But God has remembered you. The Lord has remembered his handmaid, and he has decided to visit her. On Tuesday, as the first manifestation, you're going to give a special number in our meeting. That meeting is for champions. Get a song for champion. You're also a champion, isn't it? Hallelujah. Oh, my brother. Oh, I forgot your name, you know.
Enoch.
Enoch walked with God. And God took him. Hallelujah. Brother Enoch, kneel down. Let me just bless you. Father, we bless Enoch. Hallelujah. 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 I say hallelujah. 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 And you know, God has put hallelujah in your mouth. All right. Well, brethren, I know that you wanted to go in the meeting, Abby, but I'm not sure anything is happening there. But if you still want to go, you can at least mark attendance. But on Tuesday. Now, who
is doing that? That's how some of you started your ministry. And you are expecting that that ministry will bring glory to God. No. If you want to be part of the move of God, it must be crucified. Don't tarry with what heaven will not accept. Don't be tempted to do what God is not interested in. Return those members to their owners. So that God can help you. You know it. And if you are hearing me, the cross has to come on your life. It has to come on what you are doing. It has to come on your methodology. Otherwise, there's nothing. Those that belong to Christ have. It must have to happen. If it has not happened, brothers, you are none of his. And what you are doing is not recognized by him. And even though it appears big, it will soon finish. Because when God starts, he will raise men who are dead, dead to the flesh, so that he can bring fruit unto God. Amen. Will you be able to join me to now read Galatians 2:20? Yes, 2:20.
I am crucified with Christ.
I am crucified with Christ.
Nevertheless, I live.
Nevertheless, I live.
Yet not I.
Yet it is no longer I.
But Christ liveth in me.
But Christ lives in me.
And the life which I now live in
the flesh. And the life which I now live in the flesh.
I live by the faith of the Son of God.
I live by the faith of the Son of God.
Who loved me.
Who loved me.
And gave himself for me.
And gave himself for me. CEV, please. Take it from the last line of verse 19. So that you can catch it well.
I have been nailed to the cross with Christ.
I have been nailed to the cross with Christ. Yes.
I have died.
I have died.
But Christ lives in me.
But it is Christ who lives in me now. Yes.
And I now live by faith in the Son of God.
I now live by faith of the Son of God.
Who loved me.
Who loved me.
And gave his life for me.
And gave his life for me. I have died. I have died. When Paul said, I have been crucified with Christ, that was why whatever God could now do through his life could be done. Where Mr. Flesh has not been brought to the cross, the work of God honestly has not started. And I want to confess to you, God continued to say, I cannot start anything with you until this man, who is the major obstacle, has been taken out of the way. I cannot move forward with you when this man has not been taken out of the way. And there are some of us that you are saying, why is it that God has not come to use me? Why is it that God has not come to use me? God is saying, upon man's flesh, the anointing must not be poured. I'm trusting God that this meeting will end it in the name of Jesus Christ. So I'll read that note and I go away from there. This is very major focus and mystery of the cross in setting men free
from the tyranny of sin and self. Until this has taken place, God's purpose of making you a light unto the nations will not come to pass. You cannot confront the prince of this world with the flesh, which is subservient to it. It is at the cross that the transaction of the exchange of that old life with the life of Christ, was done. Until you have experienced that death of the old man by the cross, you are still in bondage to the world system, and you have no light to shine in the overwhelming darkness that is engulfing everywhere and every profession on the face of the earth. The cross is like a valve that blocks the life of the flesh from having a free flow into you, and at the same time releases Christ's life into you. The flow of Christ's life into me is accelerated and accentuated by the daily application of the cross. As we bear about in our mortal bodies the death of Jesus on the cross, so will the life also of Christ be made manifest, released in our mortal bodies. Can I ask you now to read 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 10, verse 11, and verse 12, New King James.
Always carrying about in the body, the dying of the Lord Jesus.
Now, this thing that we have described, you are going to carry it everywhere. You are going to keep knowing, I am crucified with Christ. Before you will open your mouth to talk anywhere, you must never forget this, that the man I used to be is no more here. Before you step into anything, you must never forget, it's no longer I that live, but Christ that lives in me. Yes, sir.
Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus.
Yes.
That the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body.
Yes.
For we who live are always delivered to death.
Yes.
For Jesus' sake.
Yes.
That the life of Jesus also may be manifested
now,
in our mortal flesh.
Yes.
So then, death is working in us.
Death is at work in us.
But life in you.
So for any man that will be manifesting the life light, the death of Jesus must be working constantly in him. My brother, any day that death is not applied, any day you walk away from that death, you shall circuit the life of Jesus. May God help us. You know why I'm praying and believing God? God has continued to say that the apostles that he raised, that turned the world upside down, this was what he did to them. That's why even though they are not many, they are not like multitude, but they took their nation and shook it and brought men unto God, because they carry a life that's already dead. See? Dead to the flesh, dead to fame, dead to argument, dead to competition. Dead. Brothers, dead. Why is it that you cannot work together with a brother continuously for 5 years? Why did you have to break away? I hear you say, well, the Lord said, you were born original, don't die a copy. Which Bible verse said that? Which Bible verse were you quoting? These are verses written by the flesh. Why is that something is agitating inside of you?
How can I follow this man? How can I follow this man? What will I become? When will I become my own? How will I become my own? Hey, Mr. Flesh. So can you see in a small village where we could have combined and stand together and fight against the devil, we divided ourselves. Because Mr. Flesh said, if we join now, who will be the leader? Who will be the in charge? What's the problem? Why can't you do your own charge and leave the in charge for whosoever God has allowed? But since you want to make a name for yourself, you can't sue. We are praying that this revival will bring about the manifestation of Christ's life that can subdue the world in the name of Jesus. You will notice that number two, I did not even put scriptures because it's only a follow come on the issues we have just raised. So I'll just read it. The cross is the authentic symbol and public identification of the new creation life. It is the mark of the new creation. It marks you out for the glory of God. It sets you apart from everyone else in the world system. It is God's public mark on your life. It is his mark of approval on one's life. When you bear the cross boldly about, and you carry around at all times the death of Jesus Christ, the life of Christ is being made manifest in you, and this publicly identifies you as having the new life. The more this death is at work in you, the more the life of Christ is released and found working in the hearts of men and women around you. It is the release of this life light, Christ, life within you that actually has capacity to bring darkness down and make you a light unto the people that sit in the region of darkness. If this life light is not flowing out and shining forth, you may shout, you may even preach hard, it will not affect men who are bound in darkness in any significant way. Paul said, I bear in my body the marks of Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, there is no other way by which they identify believers in Christ in those days except by the cross. There is no other means by which God's people were identified except by the cross. The cross was laid on their lives. It was written on their lives all over. And when they are passing, you know that these men are dead to the world. They don't have any other attraction. My dear brothers, I know our generation has changed. When several of us are looking for a different identity, we want the world to know us differently. We want the world to talk about us in a different manner. So when we come around, we would like to pile up all kind of things, all kind of titles, all kind of big things, because we have lost our identity. Excuse me, what is our identity mark? The cross of Jesus, the crucified life. The crucified life. You cannot meet a brother who has experienced this death and you'll be wondering who he is. You will just see a brokenness. You just see simplicity. You just see Christ's life oozing out. He doesn't need to talk much. You know you have met a child of God. If the cross has not been laid on your life in a consistent manner, you are still going to have a mistaken identity. I read a book several years ago. That book was written by Roy Hasey. He called it The Calvary Road. Very small book. But I could not finish that book because he himself said, this book will put you on the Calvary Road. And the Calvary Road is a journey marked every step of the way by the cross. I remember praying, I said, Lord, I want to be on that road. And some of the brothers that I have first encountered in my life, that I was raising disciples, when the work started in those days in Ibadan, and they were saying, what name shall we call it? What was the name? Calvary Road. Because for me, there's no other road that leads to heaven. It's the Calvary Road. The road marked by the cross. The cross is God's identity for his church. It is not just a symbol. The cross is the coordinate. I wish I could draw a graph here. It's the coordinate axis for the new creation. That is where our old nature finished, and that's where our new life began. There is no how you can draw your graph. When they say, where is the origin? You must put the cross there. It is at the cross everything began. Those who have not come to the cross of Jesus Christ, they have not started. And I don't know, I know, sometimes it looks very harsh. It looks very harsh. There are people that God brings our way. They have become somehow like this. They have traveled for a long time in what they call ministry. And there are already things. And when they say, God said, I should come. I usually have a dilemma. Should we do bilateral conversion? Should we just say, since it's at this height? But he has never come to the origin, the cross. Can we just make him to join the line up there? God said, you are wasting his life. He will not go far. Take him back to the cross. Take him back to the cross. Let him encounter the cross again. Then his journey will be faster. There are men that I thought they are already on top. And when God wanted to do something in their lives and send them, he said, take them back to where I met you at the cross. Their journey will be faster. There are brothers that may be offended because they are already big evangelists. And when they come about, they are thinking that immediately, I hear God say, except the corn of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it abides alone. Take him to the origin. A man that has not come to the place of death at the cross, there is no future for him in the purpose of God. Brothers, in case you are hearing the Holy Spirit speak to you today, go back to the origin. Go back to the cross. Go back to Calvary. You may be wondering, is that when God wanted to help Jacob, what did he tell him? Go back to where? To Bethel. Some people are imagining and they are not happy with me. But I cannot apologize for the truth. If you have no origin in the cross, your foundation will not have the features of your future. The features of the future that God has for you is laid at the cross. Whatever it will take you to get back to Bethel, to get back to Calvary, to get back to the cross, to get back to the origin, don't hesitate. Don't waste more time. May God help and give you grace to so do in the name of Jesus. At the cross, the judgment of this world was effected and the prince of this world was cast out. At the cross, the certificate of debt hanging on our necks was annulled, and all the records that stood against us were taken out of the way and nailed to the cross. Can I now beg you? Colossians chapter 2. All of you, please open that Colossians 2 and we read verse 14 up to 15. Colossians 2. Yes, sir.
Colossians 2.
2.
14.
14.
Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us.
Yes.
Which was contrary to us.
Uh-huh.
And took it out of the way.
He took it out of the way.
Nailing it to his cross.
Nailing it to his cross.
And having spoiled principalities and powers.
Uh-huh.
He made of a show of them openly.
Yes.
Triumphing over them in it.
All right. Where is good news?
He cancelled the unfavorable record of our debts.
He cancelled the unfavorable record of our debts.
With its binding rules.
With its binding rules.
And did away with it completely.
And he did away with it completely.
By nailing it to the cross.
By nailing it to the cross. Verse 15.
And on that cross.
And on that cross.
Christ freed himself from the power of the spiritual rulers.
Uh-huh.
And authorities.
Uh-huh.
He made a public spectacle of them. By leading them as captives in his victory procession.
Hallelujah. My brother. At the cross. Every ordinance that was written against you. Actually was cancelled. All the subsisting rules that were tying you down, oppressing your life, and making you a captive, Jesus took it out of the way. He nullified them and nailed it to the cross. So when we said at the cross, burdens are lifted at Calvary, it is because at the cross, when Jesus Christ died, every ordinance, including ancestral spirits. I know several of you are going from one deliverance to another, but they have not brought you to the cross where that power was dismantled. It is as you come to Jesus, who went to the cross for you, that you will suddenly discover that all the things that they have been saying, that your destiny was tied around a tree, that your umbilical cord, when you were born, they buried your umbilical cord under a river, and one particular frog ate it, and that's why they have been eating your progress. May I inform you today, that ordinance, that arrangement, even if it was true, what has happened to it now? Cancelled. By the authority of Jesus Christ and by the work he did at the cross, we will declare you free from every spirit in the name of Jesus Christ. In fact, you will go home from here Where they say you should not enter, go and enter it. To go and demonstrate what Jesus Christ has done. He said, and on that cross, Jesus disarmed principalities and powers. He made a public display of their defeat, triumphing over them in the cross. So, brother, at the cross, every activity, every power that Satan was decorated with was removed. I told you that Satan does not like what I'm doing. He doesn't. And I know there's no man who likes for you to undress his defeat before the people that used to fear him. He doesn't like this. But I have determined under God that we will do it. And you will be free. Amen. I tell you, you will be free. Amen. Even if they said you swallow lizard, and that it is lizard that is eating your eggs. You know when you go for deliverances, they have stories. They say as you are producing egg every month, one lizard is doing what? And they will be demonstrating so that you can know that there's a lizard actually. I tell you, both the lizard and those who sponsor the lizard has been nullified. Yeah. I say to you, your eggs will produce children. Yeah. In the name of Jesus. Yeah. You are going to walk back home. Tell all those people that said, your own has been finished because they have plucked all your egg. Go and tell them, in your very eyes, my eggs that you say you ate, they will spring up again. But I even want you to know that at the cross, all of that was settled. Praise the Lord. Satan will definitely want to keep this defeat and the written judgment obscure and unknown always, as this blinded, this allows him to keep deceiving the hearts of many whose eyes are blinded, lest the light of the gospel should shine unto them. But Jesus says, now is the judgment of this world, now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And I, if I'm lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all peoples to myself. Amen. Bearing the cross about and teaching and preaching Christ and him crucified does not only release men from the tyranny of the flesh, but also from the power of him that had the power of death. I pray that the ministry of the cross, what God brought the cross to do in your life, you will not undermine it. The first thing that I painted this morning, and I spent so much time, is that at the cross, the person we used to be was crucified with him. So I can now say, I'm a new creation. I'm a brand new man. All things are passed away. I am born again. More than a conqueror. That's who I am. I'm a new creation. I'm a brand new man. I know. When you quote 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, a new creation, all things are passed away. It appears vague because you did not read from verse 14 that says, we have thus judged that if one man died for all, then all died. It's because the man we used to be has died That's why we can claim that we're a new creation and that old things have passed away. But this moment, I want you to note that when we bear the cross about, when we carry the cross as a revelation, as an experience of the death that has taken place, you are not only released from the tyranny of the flesh, but you are also released from the power of him. In fact, Satan looks at you, can do you nothing. Since I came to the experience of the cross, to me, Satan has only been looking at me from afar. Nothing. When I want to sleep, I sleep. I just scatter my leg. They say, one demon oppressed them in the night. Who are they? Eh? Who are they? To come where I am? Is a thousand will fall by your left, tens of thousands by your right, shall not come near you. Why? When Jesus finished the matter at the cross, Satan lost his power to oppress. But you see, when you don't know, you say, my people perish. For what? For lack of knowledge. If we must subdue the power of darkness in our workplaces or in our duty posts, we also must have been lifted from the earth and placed, so to say, on the cross. It is the crucified life that terminates the power of darkness. It is not first by our shouts or by other religious activities. I know all these issues I'm raising, they may be striking something in your heart. Don't say me, we should not shout again. I didn't mean you can shout. Shouting is not injurious. Shouting is not a sin. It's just that shouting does not change anything. And if you like to reserve your voice and for something useful, why don't you collect what silenced the devil as soon as you come? It is what Jesus did at Calvary, that crucified life. I don't know whether you know, when the sons of Sceva went to cast out some demons, and they said, in the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches, we adjure you, O demon, come out. And I think the demon must have done his eyes like this. Say, who are you talking to? Who are you talking to? Who are you? Who are you? Jesus, we know. And if it is Paul, we know him. But who are you? And before you go, I'm going to discipline you. The next time you don't come to talk to us, we know the people we listen to. We know those who will say one word and we will start running etasketa. And it's not because of their shout. It's because they carry a life that we can see the cross at work in it. Oh my God, when the demon jumped up and beat these seven sons of Sceva, how did the Bible say they ran out? They ran out naked. I don't have time to tell you my own story. I don't have time. How I went to cast out a demon. And as we did, you know, I don't know that the devils are very sensitive. They are sensitive. Demons are very sensitive. When you switch from the life of Christ, they know it. So when I come, you know, I say, in the name of Jesus, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, deal with this spirit. The man was mad. I said, Jesus. And then the man will kneel down. When he kneels down, I don't know, something will ring inside of him and say, yes, you are really important now. and relay this. So I woke up and I said, now, do you know we can deal with you? When I say that, immediately I say that, the demon will jump up. I say, who are you? To think you can deal with me. Who are you? Where are you coming from? I will deal with you now. So when the man opened his eyes and fear catches me, I say, no, in the name of Jesus, I'm not the one to deal with you. It is Jesus. And then the demon say, if it is Jesus, then I will kneel down. Then he will kneel down. He did that to me 3 times. When I now know that, so that night, God did something. And the man was, in fact, he suddenly saw that he was naked. He said, how am I like this? So he wore his clothes. He ate. He slept. Then we told him that by 9 a.m. we are coming to do Bible study with him. And he said, I will be waiting for you, please. Now that Jesus has touched me, I will be waiting. Now, from about 9 p.m., when we finished, are you hearing me? Instead of me to return back, I said, Jesus, thank you. So you are the one walking. So it's not I. You don't know what I did. I went from room to room, sharing testimony. God is moving now. When I spoke, I said, knee down there. The man just knelt. I was giving testimony as if I was one powerful man of God. And I gave testimony till 4 a.m. So I couldn't sleep. So when I slept, I woke up around 8. If I could have my quiet time, and I would rush to the place in Agbowo, opposite University campus in Ibadan. I ran there. I got there for 9:45. The demon stood up. I said, welcome. I was surprised. He said, you went about throughout yesterday night, gossiping about me, as if you are the one who cast me out. How did this demon know what I was doing? I said, you are talking about. And you told me to wait for you by 9. Didn't your Jesus said, let your yes be yes, and your no? Is this 9 o'clock? Brother, do you know what he did? The man just did like this. And he stood up. And he went. I thought he just wanted to go to the toilet. I was in the room when he left and he locked the door. He locked me up. It was an upstairs. I could not break the window and fall down. And then he left. From Agbogbo, he walked around. Before anybody knew where he was already in Mapo, Ibadan. Meanwhile, I was locked up. From 10 a.m. till 1 p.m., nobody to open me up. I knelt down. I cried. I prayed. I said, God, what would I have done? He said, you took my glory. You took my glory. It's not you. It's I that walked. Why were you going about talking? That's why the demon took over. And allow him to lock you up so that you can learn your lesson. So I started begging, Lord, send him back. Send him back to come and open me up. Please send him back, Lord. Send him back. You don't know how a madman suddenly began to come back. By the time he came back, he opened the door for me. Do you know what he said? He said, I just had mercy on you. I ran back to the campus. I said, Lord, now I have to repent seriously. I said, this old nature that wants to take the glory for the work of God, if you don't deliver me from it, where am I going? Where am I going? Only the crucified life can exercise the authority of the kingdom of God over the kingdom of darkness. Any other life, you'll be making noise. Even when it appears as if you're achieving anything, you are not achieving anything. It's just a preoccupation for nothing. I beg you, brothers, we're sending you forth by the grace of God to go and stand in the nation. You can't carry any life other than the crucified life. If you don't carry the crucified life and the crucified, we will be introducing you to unnecessary danger. And the devil is so furious, knowing that his time is already very short. Contrary to what many feared, that the preaching of the cross will scare people away and thin out the audience, actually, the genuine teaching and preaching of the cross is magnetic. It draws men to Christ and releases them from the shackles of the devil. And if I bear about this crucified life with the print of his nails on my hands and my mortal frame, his authority of the resurrection life flows through me to drag men into the kingdom of God. This is what I must pursue much more. Pressing forward till every suffering of his is familiar to me. In order to evoke in me and exhume from me the very life of Christ. I must pursue this till I am made conformable to his death. Carrying around in my mortal body this death of Christ, so that the life also of Christ may be made manifest in my body. I must constantly allow him to hand me over to death so that more of his life may be revealed in me. This is so that by all means I may partake of the resurrection like his. A resurrection that lifts me up and out from the dead even while I am still in this body. There is a resurrection life of the same kind like Jesus. There are many people who are merely existing, but they are not living. They are actually dead men and women walking about on the street. I cannot keep company with such men. This resurrection must lift me up and lift me out from among the dead. If you will read Philippians 3 from verse 10 to 11 in the Amplified Bible,
for my determined purpose is that I may know him, that I may progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with him, perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of his person more strongly and more clearly, and that I may in that same way come to know the power outflowing from his resurrection,
amen,
which it exacts over believers, that I may also share his sufferings as to be continually transformed in spirit into his likeness, even to his death, in the hope that if possible, I may attain to the spiritual and moral resurrection that lifts me out from among the dead, even while in the body.
This cry in the heart of Paul for the experience of the power outflowing from his resurrection must also be the cry of my own heart today. This experience will cause me and cause you to be continually transformed and changed into his own very likeness from one degree of glory to another. As I hear about this continual transformation in the spirit into his likeness, even to his death, despising the shame of the cross, it will position me to release his life to all who come in contact with me. I may also be able to say, death is at work in me, but life is released and is at work in you. What am I saying there? I have talked about the cross, the experience that must be at the origin of your walk with God. But I'm talking about the cross that is a continuous cross, a daily cross. Let him carry his cross daily. I'm now talking about the cross that we bear everywhere, that is releasing Christ's life everywhere, that at any point we meet people, they don't touch the flesh anymore, they touch the crucified life. Whether as a teacher, I'm teaching, as a lecturer, I'm lecturing, what the students are touching is Christ's life oozing out of you. Are you hearing me? Let it never happen that you are teaching and because anger, a child, a student provokes you and they must do it. It's their business. You cannot tell a boy that has not been free from the flesh not to misbehave. It is his right to do it. It's by law. And when he does, he is not asking for anything. He's only saying, excuse me, excuse me. What do you carry here? He's not asking you to misbehave. Just asking a question. Who did you carry here? Is it Christ? But can you imagine that at that moment, your eyes went red? You spoke out of annoyance. And before you knew, you said, take time. You may never graduate from this class if you did not take time. This course, all right. Do you know that all others that have been respecting you because they believe that you are a child of God and you are a senior friend, when they see you getting annoyed, not with them, but with someone else, their respect, their impression of the life they were learning from you immediately does what? It just goes and says, so uncle can get annoyed like this. Then they will talk to them and say, be very careful. When you see him laughing at with you, be careful. It's not like that. When I saw the way he addressed that boy, I said, I must be careful. So when you are coming, he said, uncle, good morning, sir. Good morning, sir. You know what they are doing? They say, be cautious with him. He looked like a sheep, but there's a lion inside him. What have you done? Your ministry among them has reduced. You no longer have the resurrection life that lifts you up from among the dead. So let me tell you now, it is not that you are quarreling with your wife that I'm talking about. You may never quarrel with your wife again. But the day you quarrel with someone else, it may actually be correct for you to be quarreling. But all those who are expecting Christ's life from you, they are immediately disappointed. Your ministry to them is reduced. So, how many times am I going to carry this cross? Everywhere. At all times. The crucified life is a continuous life to live. It's not occasional. It is the light that is beaming out, the light unto the people that God has brought us to minister to. May God help us in the name of Jesus. If you want to boast, because there are times when you are provoked and you need to boast. If at any time a Christian must boast, there's only one thing you can boast with. What is that? The cross. He said, God forbid that I should boast about anything except in the cross by which I am dead to the world and the world is crucified unto me. If there's any reason that you want to boast, you can only boast in the crucified. You can't boast in your knowledge, you can't boast in your achievement, you can't boast in your degrees. The man that boasts in all of those things, what has happened to him has been crucified, is dead. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. At the cross, the enmity between us and God was abolished and taken out of the way. I cannot go back to that because that's the essence of what we have been saying. It is at the cross that the enmity, the man that stood inside us, contrary to God, was evacuated. So it is only the crucified life that can love others so selflessly. The unity of the body of Christ, permit me to speak into this now. So many people are praying for the unity of the body of Christ, which I believe in. And you are looking for the body of Christ to be united. But can I tell you, the only thing that has scattered the body of Christ is what? Is what? Is the flesh. There's nothing more. Nothing. And not to confront the flesh and be trying to form association is a waste of time. To pamper the flesh and not confront it, people cannot be together. It is only at the cross, the message of the cross and the crucified life that can enhance the unity of the body of Christ. Because the enmity between man and man, the social strata that divides us, say, how can I drink from that cup and that get drunk from it? You don't know me. Do you know my class? Ah, you can go and learn how to serve an elder. Is it because I'm a brother? That you are now treating me like anybody else? Who told you that So when you see social and you see status and you see division, this one is bigger, this one is smaller, is the flesh. There is nothing different there. Did you see what God can do? When Mr. Flesh had been confronted, you see professors, you see primary school students, you see brothers who are just coming from the village, you see all of us eating together, living together, walking together. And sometimes when I say, Prof, he say, no, call me brother. I'm a brother. And then suddenly, this young man that did not know that this brother is a prof, who thought it was, when he suddenly said, I'm very sorry, sir. I didn't know, I was just arrogant for nothing. It is the cross that brings people down. If I want you to labor, which is a critical work God has called us to do, to build up the body of Christ, where there is no Jew, no Greek, where we can be one with one another, where we can come from different denominations and we will be brethren. The message that causes that to happen is the cross. If we don't preach Christ and Him crucified, my brother, there is no way the barrier between us and God, the barrier between men and women, the barrier between tribes and tongues could be broken. It was only at the cross. What happened at the Tower of Babel was only reversed on the cross, and thereby bringing all who come to the cross of Christ into oneness of life, where there is no Jew or Greek, barbarian, educated. Since you have put on the new man, who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of Him who created him. Is anybody anywhere able to read Colossians 3, 10 and 11 for me from Living Bible, the old Living Bible, not New Living Translation, Living Bible? You have it? Yes, the brother. Just read.
Colossians 3,
10 and 11.
10 and 11.
Yes.
You are living a brand new kind of life.
Now, yes.
That is continually learning more and more of what is right.
Yes.
And trying constantly to be more and more like Christ, who created this new life within you. In this new life.
In this new life.
One's nationality or race. Or education.
Uh-huh.
Or social position.
Uh-huh.
Is unimportant.
Unimportant.
Such things means nothing.
Uh-huh.
Whether a person has Christ is what matters.
That's what matters.
And He is equally available to
in
all.
In this new life, all of those things that Mr. Flesh capitalized on does not matter. That's not the issue to talk about. But you see, when Mr. Flesh has not died, we'll be looking for everything that could make, yes, let me have some water. We'll be looking for everything that can create the dichotomy of the flesh. We'll not be looking for opportunity to serve one another, but we'll only be looking for position where we can be served as our coordinate. That is the point at which everything God wants to do with us actually can be done. When we said the cross is our coordinate, what we are saying is that from the cross and from what God has accomplished, we now have the audacity to establish the kingdom of God on the earth. We have the mandate and the honor to cast out the principalities and powers and to execute the written judgment. It is the perfect divide between the old and the new. And all who were before us in the Old Testament labored, and they were looking forward to the time the cross will actually take place, not knowing that God has reserved it for us and not for them. It marks the beginning of God's restoration of all things. Praise the Lord. The cross itself is the power of God. It is not a means of getting power. One of the misunderstandings that has not allowed us to deal with the cross is that many people think that when we preach about the cross, we don't have power. Like some of you are sitting here, you think that, oh, this kind of meeting, there's no power. In your mind, power is in shouting. In your mind, you think power is in what you call ministration. So that when the man of God just can't say, and then it does like that, and you all collapse. When you have collapsed, then you say, yes, they have been slain. You know, I kept checking whether that is a phenomenon, whether Jesus practiced it. whether it was a mark of a spiritual anointing. The only time I found that when Jesus spoke, somebody did as if he was dead, was when an epileptic spirit was to be cast out. So when a man of God said, all of you will be slain, I'm asking, are we all epileptic here? But you know, because it's a facade, it is fading out. It has faded now. There was a time when the only mark to know that you're a man of God, highly anointed, is for someone just to come and say, you'll be slain. Then all of the people will just fall down, go, 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 go. I used to wait to see what will happen when they wake up. Not, they will just jump up and do like this. They are conscious enough that their body is dirty. They do like this. That shows nothing actually happened. And then they will sit back in the meeting as if nothing has happened, waiting for another man to say his own. This kind of useless activities that has made the church a place of theatrical practice where you just do theater. No. The cross is the power of God. When you teach and preach about the cross, power is released. Are you hearing me? Genuine power is released. Power to change men. Power that releases them from the power of darkness is released. That power is not a drama, it's power. That power is not what somebody is shaking, shaking, shaking. No, it's real power. I mean, I have seen people that were oppressed for years and you simply confronted them with the cross and suddenly they are released. And they come back and say, that thing, since you talked to me, since that simple prayer, it has never come back. I say, it can never come back again. You don't need to be coming for checkup. But some of you are sitting here. You go every week for what? For checkup. Checkup so that the demons. So have you gone for your checkup? I say, oh man of God, we have missed it. Can I send you forth in the name of Jesus to preach Christ and him crucified? The cross is the power of God for changing men. Every deliverance from all ancestral spirits, ordinances so promulgated and substituting against us was nullified at the cross and discarded. Read all of that on your own. Finally, every knee shall bow to the crucified. Number 15. Every knee shall bow to the crucified. The nail pierced hands. Is it the hand for healing and for deliverance? The blood of his cross. Is it the blood of the everlasting covenant? This is why we must preach it with all our strength and live by it with every breath God gives us. This is why we must write books that illustrate this important mystery of God for this generation. God will help us to be faithful and to live, and if necessary, to die, preaching nothing else but Christ and him crucified. There is no expectation I must have in life and in ministry apart from this. I must not look for anything else in those who hear us to preach or come near us for discipleship except to see Christ and him crucified, born and formed in them. I must see them being single-eyed on Christ, who must be set plainly, clearly, and particularly as being crucified among them from place to place, from congregation to congregation, from one set to another one. It must be our signature tune for everything we do. No one can accompany with us in this work that God has called us to do unless he has seen this very clearly and personally experienced it in his life. Paul said, I resolved to know nothing, to be acquainted with nothing, to make a display of the knowledge of nothing, and to be conscious of nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. To be the light to the nations, every dross must be removed from you. And to shine the light that is life, the alabaster box, the pitchers must be broken. It is the same strategy the Lord gave to Gideon in dealing with the multitude of the Midianites who gathered against them for battle. Only 300 men who have experienced the crucified lion and who are broken and remain breakable, bearing the torches of light within their earthen vessels, are enough to discomfit the thousands. They had only one message to blow with the trumpet in their hands. Self has been dethroned, and no one speaks of himself or preaches himself anymore. They all proclaim the Christ and him crucified. While you may think God requires multitude to fight his battles, God only requires the 300 who have ended all their allegiance to self and the world system. They have ended all their fears, and they were ready to lap the water with their tongue while they face the battle for the Lord. This is the point at which we must stop. I will now ask you to please stand up and let's pray together. Would you like to just remember what God has said to you today? We said one major mystery and the ministry which the cross has brought to us is the termination of our old nature, our old man. Only those who have been crucified with Christ can also belong to Christ. Only those who have experienced Christ's death as their own death can sincerely be recruited to his service. He cannot get married to one who is still married to the flesh. Please pray about this now and ask God. This matter must end here. I want to stop by saying it is at the cross that Jesus said it is finished. Things will not finish if you're married to Mr. Flesh. Your connection to the flesh, if it is not brought to death. I want you to honestly pray. If the Holy Spirit is dealing with you and saying, why will you waste what he did at the cross? Are you claiming to belong to Christ while you are all the way married to the flesh? Are you being deceived to say, I'm serving Christ, when behind all your activity, including the ministry you are performing, is motivated for the flesh and by the flesh? How will you be claiming to belong to him when someone else is claiming every product of your life? Only those that have experienced him, experienced his death, can actually become part of his work. Let's pray together. Holy Spirit, that men may see Christ as crucified among them this morning. That they may see the man of Calvary who took away that man that we used to, that used to use us, whose motions worked in our members by law, Lord, cause your children to see that it was crucified. I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ that lives in me. Holy Spirit, please mark this today for us and make this a turning point in the life of your people. That this day, whether old or young, experienced or inexperienced, we are coming back to the cross. We are coming back to Calvary. It's a back to Bethel. But for us, it's back to Calvary. Back to the foot of the cross, where everything must be dropped down so that there can be a fresh coordinate, an origin for what you want to do with our lives. Thank you. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. Amen.